welcome, sir.
Thank you, and thanks to the organizers for inviting me to give this talk. This is by no means a deliberate lateral ligament tear, which I wanted to advertise my own offloading. Right. Offloading the diabetes foot, the question was, do we need to offload? Of course, offloading is actually paramount and most important, absolutely essential, and there's no question of it. Even if you treat infections, even if you look at other modalities in terms of good control of diabetes, offloading is absolutely essential. Just to mention the pioneers for offloading from CMC, of course, most people do know Paul Brand, who was a pioneer for leprosy offloading, and of course all his ideas are now translated into for diabetes. And of course, what is lesser known is that Paul Brand was nominated for the final round of the Nobel Prize in 1965. Mary Varghese, who founded the rehabilitation department, and of course Suranjan Bhattacharjee, who really developed the systems over there. We have learned as a Department of Endocrinology a lot from the rehabilitation department and the PMR unit in CMC Vellore. So our diabetes foot clinic consists of these components, essentially that of the physician, the rehab department, the vascular surgeon, the prosthetist and orthotist, and the people who actually help in manufacture of footwear, the physiotherapists and our diabetes educators. This is the unit which actually helps in manufacturing almost 80 bits and pieces of various forms of prosthesis, orthotist and other forms of things which are important for rehabilitation. So very briefly, I'll start with footwear per se, and as my previous speaker had mentioned, is that shoes should not be too tight or too loose. There should be adequate foot width and adequate foot depth. Otherwise, you can aggravate ulcers which already are there, or induce ulcers as well. As mentioned over here, the classical footwear has an outsole which prevents sharp objects from passing through, and an insole which has an adequate show value or hardness. The entire footwear should not ideally have metallic components, because they could cut into the skin, and ideally have Velcro straps. The toe box should be wide, as mentioned, and should not crush the toes. As you can see over here, the various components, and you need a heel counter, and ideally speaking, most patients with diabetes require a back strap. Because there is subtle motor neuropathy in most patients, the feet tend to slip out of the footwear, and therefore a back strap is very important. Okay, so there are several types of footwear which have been mentioned, and I will try and cover all these aspects in the next 15 minutes or so. Generally, insole materials consist of various types. The most time tested is microcellular rubber, but make sure it is proper, authenticated microcellular rubber. There are various other forms which have been used, but they have been much less time tested and have much less been put through trials before patenting. So here, as you can see over here, I've already talked about the hard outsole and the soft insole, but I am reiterating this. So when you see your patients with diabetes, ensure that they have these components with an adjustable front strap and a back strap. How do you check microcellular rubber quality? So if it's too soft, your foot will sink and hit the ground. So basically, when you have the rubber, make sure that you can put your two fingers in, press it a little bit, but your fingers should not meet in the center. Incidentally, MCR was invented in Karigiri, which is our sister institution in Vellore, and in collaboration with the MRF company. Another device which is very useful is the durometer, which is quite cheap. It costs around something like 4,000 to 5,000 rupees. Our last one, which we purchased, has lasted more than 12 years. You stick this thing, it has a needle at the tip, and it measures a show value, which looks at the hardness, and the normal show should be anywhere from 8 to 15, your show values. If it's more, it's too hard, and as rubber is used for a longer period of time, it tends to become harder. That's why the MCR footwear, particularly in agrarian cultures and particularly in rural areas, should be changed every 3 months to 6 months. A simple way of offloading areas of callosities is doing a scoop in the rubber. So all you need is your local cobbler to do that in the MCR rubber. That's what you require. Now, when you look at the Well, examine the patient. The first thing is, of course, you look at the gait of the person as they walk into the room. Then you look at them from the front and from the back and examine the ankle. A high arch basically shows a bulging on the inside part of the foot, and the heel is turned inwards. So here is a high arch foot, a classical one. It may be due to wasting due to diabetes or neuropathy, but it could also be due to a congenital high arch foot. And these people are more prone for problems. There are prominent pressure points on the fifth metatarsal, the ball of the great toe, and the fourth and the fifth metatarsals. So for this, what you do, you can use what is called a plantar metatarsal pad. Alright, and you can see over here the person has developed a callosity on the big toe, and you cut out that particular area, so that part is suspended in midair and does not come into contact with the flow. Over here you can see, basically these are simple cutouts, it's all common sense when it comes to offloading. You can get your local shoemaker to actually do this. So over here, a callosity in the center, then you have plantar metatarsal pads with wings when there are callosity on the lateral and the medial aspects. One of the things to prevent ulceration on a long-term basis is to put a filler inside the arch. So the arch actually becomes lower when you have a filler pad. These are other things which can be done. So you have multiple callosities which tend to occur in the anterior part of the foot frequently. You can put a rocker, you can put an anterior rocker, and this has become part of, it's almost like a custom-made footwear which we have for almost all our patients. The anterior rocker has come to stay as part of a basic modality for patients who have the diabetes foot in many patients. So here you have the opposite, a low arch foot, pes planus. Can be congenital, of course, can be due to Charcot's, but when you see symmetrical, short duration diabetes, pes planus, it means it's probably congenital. And over here, the arch tends to collapse. You look at the prominence of the Achilles tendon, which is seen over here. There's the heel which turns outwards, and the tendon looks curved. So the low arch foot has a propensity for callosities in the second and third metatarsal head, the interphalangeal joint of the great toe, and also the tips of the lesser toes. Over here, you can use what is called, you have to actually accentuate, create an artificial arch. So over here, you use something what is called a hathi pad. It looks exactly like an elephant's trunk. That's why it's called the hathi pad. So you have two components, the heel meniscus, which extends onto the lateral aspect of the trunk of the elephant, and the medial aspect which fills in the arch. So this can reduce the pressure on the pressure points which I just mentioned. Forefoot ulcers, of course, are most common in diabetes for various reasons which I have already explained. And one of the easy ways out was creating what is known as a clog. This clog is something which originated from Holland. Basically, these kind of things are hardened shoes which are utilized. And over here, you can see the clog is externally elevated and you have a wooden component over there. Now, over here, you have a patient who had a clog, but it's only undergone partial healing. So, there are several reasons why this might be happening. Now, I must mention that an important part of healing in offloading is training a patient how to walk properly. Alright? As we grow older, we all develop peculiarities in gait, and if you have diabetic neuropathy in addition, and you probably have a CNS problem which coincides, the gait, the normal process of gait is lost. So you have to train your patients to learn how to walk properly, how not to take large steps, take small, short steps, and not to put pressure on the areas of ulceration. So one of the things which has replaced the clog is now the rocker. Over here, you have a rocker. So a rocker basically is something which is intrinsic over there. As you can see, the anterior rocker which is created in this foot. And you can have different angles of rockers which are used over here. And this is something which is now routinely used in many of our patients who have diabetes. It's been popularized by our bioengineering team in the Department of Artificial Limb Center. So the other thing is the heel counter in addition, and the surgical shoes once you have already had a complete or a partial amputation. So here is a serial set of pictures of a patient who came, was initially tried with the scoop, which I showed you, the Asian scoop and the MCR rubber, then was given a microcellular rubber with a metatarsal bar. And there's some partial healing, but it still is taking ages. Of course, it could be compliance, it could be other reasons. But finally, included a 4-foot rocker, and it heals pretty fast. So this has come to stay. Here's another example where a 4-foot rocker was used. So here is another patient who has two ulcers in the sole of the foot of fairly large size, and a third ulcer on the dorsal aspect of the foot. And there's an infection. So because of the infection and the foul smell, persistent infection, plantar space infection, there was a left transmetatarsal amputation done. And this is the basic outcome of surgery. You can see it's granulating pretty well, but it's still taking ages to heal. So that's now 2.5 to 3 months, it's not healed. So what has been done over here? You use a customized anterior rocker. This is a specific surgical shoe which is utilized for these patients. Fairly simple to make once you have trained your orthotic specialist. So once this has been instituted, you can see that it tends to heal much faster, and you have a totally healed ulcer base, you know, within a period of 5 months. Here you can see surgical shoes with an external metatarsal bar. You have internal metatarsal bars, you also have external metatarsal bars. So this can be implanted in. The other thing is the patient should be taught how, not only how to walk, but also how to sit. So we can see over here, the patient has got a surgical shoe, but he's tending to slouch over, and that can cause an abnormal pressure on the foot in addition. So you must tell him to sit up straight and how to place his foot adequately. So we finish with forefoot ulcers. We talk next about midfoot and hindfoot ulcers. So the total contact cast is the best treatment for these ulcers. You know, it's difficult to get your weight off the hindfoot. The forefoot, okay, you can lift. A lot of the weight is transferred onto the hindfoot in normal situations. So that's okay. You can probably transfer your body weight onto the hindfoot. But if you have a hindfoot ulcer, you have a big problem, because bearing the weight on the entire forefoot is not going to happen, alright? So if you have an ulcer which is there in this kind of a situation, the best treatment is a total contact cast. The only thing is compliance. Walking around with this kind of a thing for 6 to 8 weeks is something which may not be acceptable to the normal urban person. It's going to be difficult. People are worried about their cosmetics. But that is the best, and total contact cast can be used in most patients with hindfoot or midfoot ulcers, except for those who have acute infections, those who don't want to use it, obviously, very demanding ulcers, and if you have a very gross external deformity. So, over here, here's an example. A patient who was on treatment had an ulcer which increased in size, and here you can see this ulcer. This is going to be difficult to heal. How do you expect this patient not to walk on the heel? So what you do is you create a contact cast, you have a window to prevent it so that you can actually see what's happening there, and you have a total contact cast. If it's totally clean, you can change the cast every 1 week or 10 days, and you have a bow line at the bottom over there so the patient can actually walk on the bow line. And with this, it is actually, once you started utilizing this from May on up to July, in about 2 months, the whole thing heals pretty fast. So this is the beauty of the cast and offloading. Here you have another example of an ulcer which is after an amputation of the big toe. You can see the ulcer is on the anterior part of the big toe stump and also extending to the plantar surface. Alright, doesn't heal we know from our experience, and here the patient has accepted this kind of a cast. You put the cast, you put a bow line under, and this has taken a while, but otherwise it might have gone on for 2 or 3 years and not healed at all. So there are other, if you don't like total contact cast, so the patient doesn't like it, sorry, you have other options. You can use removable cast walkers, which I will show you, boots, you can have crutches and walker. These are the simple things. If patients are compliant, have good upper limb strength, don't have osteoarthritis, you can use crutches. So the opposite leg is okay, you can use crutches. As you grow, those who are more elderly, 65, 70 plus, particularly in those who have diabetes, they will have OA, they have more severe neuropathy, they can't balance themselves, so crutches become difficult.
The next thing is using a walker. If they can't use a walker, then they become wheelchair bound and use a wheelchair. So those are the various options that you have. Shakots is a special situation. So over here is a classical Shakots where you have the Mijanovic classification and you have type 4 and 5. The tarsal, the talonavicular joint is dislocated, and you can see this is a rocker bottom foot. This is a one. If there's no ulcer, what do you do for Shakots? So one thing is using the total contact cast, but then what do you do long term? Once the bones are aggregated together and have kind of congregated together, it's they form a kind of an orthosis by themselves, a single bone, and they are less prone for further damage. But what do you do long term? You need to protect them on a long term basis. So one thing is using a molded insole. So you have your molded insole, very simple to make, once again put inside the MCR footwear. And here is the patient with the molded insole, which has been utilized. If it is unstable, that is if the talonavicular joint is dislocated or the calcaneum is pushed either posteriorly or towards the side, and particularly in those who have had chronic arthritis, it is an unstable joint. You cannot use a molded insole. So then you need to look at other things. You can use, a simple one is having this kind of a ankle-foot orthosis. Once again, a fairly simple instrument. Of course, here also you need compliance when the patient is using it. Even for those 5 meters of walking to the bathroom, patient should be compliant, even in the middle of the night. So you need to make sure this happens. The pneumatic walker brace can be used, also extremely good, but compliance is important. Patient doesn't feel like using it, takes it off. Mind you, even these things aren't all that light. They can be fairly heavy. So it needs a lot of persistence, a lot of training, a lot of repeated visits to make sure the patient is compliant. Here you can see the ankle foot orthosis over here, just fitted in. Provided the patient is compliant, this is great. And the air cast, pneumatic cast, which can be used over here. And finally, the Shakots assistant, orthotic walker, which is really compact, little more expensive, but can be used. There are varying costs for these kinds of appliances. So this is actually very effective. It looks a little smart. So if you're an executive kind of person going to an office, you can make people believe that they're using leather footwear in this situation. So here is a little algorithm which may be of some help. You have a simple ulcer, MCR with anterior rocker. There's a whole lot of paraphernalia which I talked about, but making it simple. MCR with anterior rocker, midfoot or hindfoot, total contact cast is great. It's the best. Tell your patients otherwise, it may take a couple of years. Use this, it will get cured in 2 or 3 months. Then over here, if you have an amputation, which is a ray or a transmetatarsal amputation, surgical shoes with an anterior rigor and a metatarsal bar, molded insole, and finally ankle foot orthosis. So here's another little table which may be of some help for you. If you have your protective sensation intact, the monofilaments are less than 10 grams or preferably 2 grams down, MCR, footwear, slip-ins, but I never said slip-ins, I always suggest back straps to everybody. Loss of protective sensation, back straps have to be used, no doubt about it. The other additions which I talked about, rigid rocker sandals, and there's gross scarring of the foot and deformity. And when you have a Shakots neuroarthritic joint, you need to have the FUB. So in summary, footwear is an integral part of diabetes management. You need a team approach to handle this problem. Well, at least you, a physiotherapist, and someone who can help you make the footwear for you, rehab of the patient with those with deformities and ulcers and amputations are your primary goal, and custom-made footwear is required for the success of healing. I'd like to thank a number of people who have contributed towards all the wonderful work and those beautiful photographs over here. My colleagues in the Department of Endocrinology, wonderful consultants, diabetes educators, and the accessory departments. Thanks so much.
Thank you, sir.